Hi, so welcome to the third part in this series on replacing CD32 17s on MacBook boards. So we're in the same situation as we were at the end of the last video. Let me remind you of what we did, because even though the video is 1 hour long, the summary is very simple. It is that all we had to do at this point was replace this 0 ohm resistor with a 140 kilo ohm resistor and move this resistor here, move this resistor here. This allowed us to configure properly the I2C addresses for our CD3217, which is a vanilla one coming from an A2338. It allowed us to configure properly the I2C addresses for this controller so that it can speak properly to the Thunderbolt controller inside the CPU and it can speak properly to the SMC, which is also inside the CPU. After doing this, we still had only one problem. The board is almost completely functional. It only has one problem, which is that it cannot charge from the left port. Everything else seems to work. And in this video, I'm going to explain to you how this can be solved. The way you solve it is by this time studying the power sequence to see where it fails. When I'm connecting one of these ports, so let's say when I'm connecting this port to power, what should happen is that first, the 5 volts from power, which is called Vbus, arrives to the CD3217. It will then turn on its two LDOs, the 3v3 LDO and the 1.5 LDO core. Then this will activate inside the CD3217 an inrush limiter, which will then pass the 5 volts from Vbus to the rest of the board and going to this fuse here. And then it will become PPDC and AON for always on. And then PPDC and AON goes to the charging IC, which is then responsible for creating PPBus AON and then powering the rest of the board. So let's see how this sequence goes on our device. So I'm connecting the board to power. And I'm getting so 50 milliamps staying at 5 volts. So in the previous video, you should remember it was 30 milliamps. That's because I hadn't turned this on. This pulls 20 milliamps when it's turned on. If I turn it off, we're back to 30 milliamps. So anyway, it's pulling 30 milliamps, but it doesn't seem to be doing anything else. Let's measure actually what is voltages to see where we are in the power sequence. So let me give you the multimeter here. So LDO 1.5 is at 1.5, LDO 3v3 is at 3.45, which is good. And PPDC and AON is at 5 volts. So at least the CD3217 is passing the Vbus all the way to the rest of the board. Now we have to look at the charging IC and what it's doing. So we want to measure PPBus, which can be measured. So for people familiar with these boards, we have two fuses, which on these two fuses, we can measure PPBus, and we can see that here PPBus is at 0.33 volts. So we have no PPBus, and this is most probably why the board is not working. So we have to figure out why PPBus is not present. So we go to the schematic, and we're gonna go to the page with the charging IC, which is here PBUS supply and battery charger, page 28. This is the ISL 9240, which we're very familiar with. It's the same, it works basically the same as the ISL 9239, almost. But the working, let's say it doesn't work exactly the same. This is a buck converter and a boost converter at the same time, but the previous ones were only buck converters. But the working conditions are the same. It takes power in from the PN pin, which is our PPDC and AON, which is present. We already measured that. But it also needs an enable. When it's powered by a charger, it needs an enable, which is this here, charger aux detect. And what should this be? Well, charger aux detect is here, PPDC and AON going through this voltage divider, but there's also this MOSFET here. So the MOSFET can either be in closed or open state. What I call closed state, closed is when it closes the circuit here between drain and source, and open state is when this path from drain to source is open. So if it's in closed state, this means that here this is going directly to ground and charger aux detect will be at 0 volt. If it's in the open state, then we don't care about it because this is an open line and we just have a classic voltage divider. And if we want to know what we should be getting here, knowing this is 5 volts, well, we just use the voltage divider formula, which is we do 5 times 255 divided by 255 plus 750, and we should be getting 1.26 volt. If we get 1.26 volt, this enables the charging IC and makes it turn on. Do we have this? So we're looking for R5216. Which is located here. We're going to flip the board. So this, keep this in mind because we're going to measure it. This is R5216. This is our MOSFET. This is the gate of the MOSFET. And this is the charger aux detect. So R5216 is here. I'm going to flip the board to get to the charging IC. And which is here, and I'm going to have to, okay. So we're going to be in this orientation here. We were in the correct orientation before. So good, R5216 is here, the MOSFET is here. Let's go to the microscope. Charger aux detect, we're getting 0 volts. So this explains why the charging IC is not working. It's not getting the enable. So this is the MOSFET. The gate is 3.3. Go back to the schematic. So this MOSFET here, I can't remember if it's a P or N. It doesn't matter. What matters is the arrow here. The arrow pointing to the gate tells me that when the gate is much higher than the source, then the MOSFET closes. If the gate is not much higher than the source, then the MOSFET opens. Here we have 3.3 volts on the gate. The source is 0 volts. So it is normal that the MOSFET closes. So the MOSFET is closed, therefore this is pulled to ground, and this explains why we have 0 volts here on charger aux detect. So one solution would be just remove the MOSFET. And most probably the board will work. But this is not a good idea. Let's just figure out why we're getting 3.3 volts at the gate. So, charger aux detect. So we can see charger aux detect comes from UPC5 GPIO6. So we don't care about UPC5 because we're powering the board from UG400, which is UPC2. So this is not what we're interested in. Here, oh, there, PD UPC2 GPIO5. Here there's a 0 ohm resistor, RH008. But the 3.3 volt is coming from this. So PD UPC2 GPIO5. So this is actually coming from UG400. And what are GPIOs? So GPIO stands for general purpose IOs. These are pins of an IC which can be programmed, which can be customized through programming. So most likely this chip has programming that tells it to send 3.3 volts on PDU on GPIO5, which then goes through this 0 ohm resistor and then goes to the MOSFET and closes the MOSFET, which pulls the charger aux detect to ground. So what would the solution be? Well, let's see. PDGPIO5. PDGPIO5. So there's RG402, but it says it's no stuff. So let's make sure that this is no stuff. Where's RG402? RG402 is here. Let's make sure, and RH008 is here. Let's switch to the microscope, go back here. So RG402 indeed is not present. However, what is it? RH008 is present. That's the 0 ohm resistor that makes the 3.3 volt go to the MOSFET. So what I'm gonna do is simply remove this resistor, which will leave the gate of the MOSFET floating, and therefore this will not trigger the MOSFET to close. So let's do this. Since I don't want to lose it, I just disconnect one pin. And let the board cool down. Yep, the board is cool. And now, let's see what happens if I connect this to power. So, there you go. Let's move this out of the way. So this is my right port, the one that was not reacting at all. Look up here. Oh, 20 volts, and the board is turning on. And that's it. If you connect a battery to the board, let me find my battery. Where did I put it? I put it here. So remember I told you that before doing this modification, the board would not power from here and would not charge from this port. So I didn't show it, but you can try, or you can just trust me. About connecting it. And it's charging. So now we restored every functionality to the board through these modifications. So in summary, because I know the previous video was long, and I know this one is probably, what is it, 15 minutes, about 16 minutes. So that's a lot of information. But in summary, if I take an ACE2 from an A2338 and I want to put it in place of UG400 and I want everything to work, what do I have to do? So of course, replace the chip. Replace this resistor by a 140k ohm resistor. Move this one here, move this one here, and just disconnect this one. And then it all works. So hopefully everything was clear and you understood. I hope that you understood everything. If there's something that's not clear, please post a comment or ask a question on the Facebook group, the MacBook Logic Board Repair Facebook group. I'll be happy to answer with whatever I know. There's still a lot of stuff that I don't know, and this will be the end for this, the first leg of this series. Then I experimented on other stuff. The next part will be about changing the USB controllers on the left side of the board. So that would be, can we replace this guy, or this guy by vanilla CD3217s? I already know the answer for this one and this one. This one I don't know yet because I just haven't tried yet, but I'm pretty sure that I know how to do it. I mean, if what I explained in the previous video applies, then I will be able to make it work. So anyway, thank you very much for watching, and see you in the next video, which I'll probably won't be making right away. I will take a little time off to prepare for it and to rest. Thank you again for watching. Bye bye.